Delivering exceptional customer experiences has moved well beyond a nice to have. It's increasingly a business imperative. Customers want to be able to reach organizations on their own terms, in the channels they prefer, and at the times that fit into their lives. And they increasingly demand personalized interactions in every sense of that term. Delivering that kind of experience doesn't just happen. It requires a deep level of experience orchestration with data, systems, and people working in concert. I'm Greg Thomas from Genesys. Join us today in the CX Greenroom with our guest, Peter Graf, Senior Vice President of Strategy at Genesys, as we discuss the different levels of experience orchestration, the benefits of each level, and why it's so critical for organizations to level up to take advantage of increasingly sophisticated AI. Peter, welcome to the show. We're glad you're here.
Hey, Greg. Thanks for having me.
Can you share a little bit about your background with our viewers and your role at Genesys, please?
Yeah, I have a background in computer science and economics. More specifically, I actually have a specific time when I studied AI, but then I had to wait like 30 years for it to become relevant. I started at Genesys in 2018. I had a variety of different roles in product operations and now in strategy.
Yeah, and it's a good reminder, right, that AI is not in and of itself new, but the applications continue to advance.
That's right. It's one of those things that always was like on the verge of having a breakthrough, and everyone feels like, okay, we have arrived.
We have arrived.
This is the time when it really hits mainstream.
Yeah. So as I mentioned in the introduction, experiences need to be orchestrated. We use that term experience orchestration a lot. Can you define that for our viewers, just so we're all on the same page?
Yeah. The purpose of orchestrating experiences is to really bring the front and the back office together to better serve the customer, essentially. And it has a lot to do with AI. When I, however, talk to people about AI in the contact center today, most of them think about automation only. Like, how can I use a bot of sorts to take traffic away from humans and serve people in a self-service motion, which obviously will save you money? That is only a small part of what we would consider orchestration. Orchestration, in addition to automation of experiences, also includes the augmentation of experiences, specifically with employees. So how can I deliver information in the moment to make the employee more efficient and effective? And as I said, if efficiency and effectiveness, scale, cost play a big role both in automation and augmentation.
Yeah.
But there's more to orchestration. There's
the other side.
There's the other side. There's the side of the consumer. And so orchestration also includes the generation of really personalized and empathetic experiences. So how can I use AI to create an experience that is different based on the context of the players?
Yeah.
Or how can I use AI to truly optimize the overall business or all of these experiences together? So experience orchestration is really four things. It's automation and augmentation on one side, driving efficiency and scale. Mm-hmm. And on the other side, it's about generating experiences that are personal and empathetic and optimize the business, which obviously drives loyalty for consumers and employees, but also long-term growth. And the story is you need both sides to reap the benefits of AI in the best possible way.
Yeah, and I think it's one of those things where as a consumer, we sort of intuitively know when the experience that we're having in, a customer support engagement is just better orchestrated, right? It feels more natural. We don't have to repeat that information. It just kind of flows in a different way.
But there's a nice example I like to use, which is a simple use case of resetting a password, right? Happens all the time. Someone contacts a brand, I can't log in. For you and me who've done this 1,000 times, it's fine that a bot just throws out a URL and we click on it, we serve ourselves, right? This is easy. We've done this 1,000 times. In our context, resetting a password is just finding the URL and then we're on our own.
Right.
For my father-in-law, who's not a digital native, resetting a password is a 20-minute adventure and he needs to be talked through it. And so same use case, reset the password, very different execution. And that's what orchestration really does.
Yeah, it's a great example because that brings in that idea of personalization and knowing who the person is.
Right.
So this isn't new in a lot of ways, but it's being accelerated by everything you talked about, the sort of needs and demands on the side of the organization, changing customer expectations. So we talk at Genesys about the idea of these levels of experience orchestration.
Right.
And so before we dive into what those different levels are and the benefits that they provide, why is having a framework to help people understand where they are on this continuum of orchestrating experiences, why is that so important, do you think?
Well, first of all, I think it's important that a company like Genesys leads in the market by putting out a vision of what's going to happen over the next couple of years. I think that's truly important. And we've kind of set out this vision that orchestration is moving all the way to what we would call universal orchestration, going back to this objective of breaking down the silos between the front and the back office to better serve customers and to really create new experiences and to really allow companies to reimagine their contact center and at the end of the day, reimagine the way how they run their business. Yeah. That's all the way out there. I think it's important for a company like Genesys, who's leading in the market, to say, hey, we have an idea of how this AI thing is going to play out over time. That's number one.
Yeah.
Number two, there are a lot of people who are just overwhelmed with what's going on in AI. There's so many things that are happening, so many capabilities that get this AI sticker on it. And it's confusing to actually make sense all of it. And that's why we define these levels of orchestration to help people understand a little bit better, where do I stand right now and what options do I have at this moment?
Yeah,
the whole concept actually was inspired by self-driving cars, and I remember sitting in that Tesla in April where self-driving was open for everybody and trying this out, going through the city here, and it was extraordinary. And we are all on a path where innovation happens quickly, and we wanted to give people a way to understand how far are they and what should they expect to come over the next 5, 10, 15 years.
Yeah, and I think that analogy to sort of self-driving cars and the levels of autonomy there is pretty helpful, right? Because that way, if I'm shopping for a vehicle, I sort of know intuitively what I'm going to be getting if I look at this car that has level 2 versus this car that has 2+.
Exactly. And we go from cruise control to dynamic cruise control and lane assist. And then we go to, semi-autonomous driving and so forth. And so we're kind of familiar with that. We thought that's a really great concept to transport that into AI and into how experiences will be orchestrated or are orchestrated right now in companies.
So let's dive into it then. So when we think about the levels of experience orchestration, what are they? And sort of at a high level, what does each one entail?
So, there is six levels. We mark them from 0 to 5. The first level of experience orchestration is no orchestration, zero orchestration, so to say, which is humans do everything. And that's the times before IVRs, before all these things, where there was a phone number and someone would call in and there would be a switchboard operator. And they would actually take care of people. Yeah. And the most common user experience in those days was a busy signal. Yeah. You didn't even get through. Now, if we look at the levels of orchestration, there's always aspects of automation, like, how can I take traffic away from people? There's aspects of augmentation and other aspects of generation and of optimization, as I explained earlier. So if we go to level 1, this is the time when we invented IVRs. And it's important to understand where we come from to see how this is evolving over time all the way to level 5. So level 1 automation is IVRs. The way how we were actually augmenting the experience is by bringing up information to the user. This is this customer's name, for example, by integrating it with some ERP or CRM system in the background. Mm. And essentially, working through this with routing, managing skills, routing calls, that's how the experience itself was generated. And so, level 1 usually happened in voice. Yeah. And I would say there's still a lot of companies who run level 1 orchestration. They've got a voice contact center. They, got an IVR going. They do their routing. They've got skills management in the background to know who to route to, and that's that. And so specifically on-prem, lots of people use level one orchestration.
Yeah. Yeah, so better for the customer, a little bit easier to manage for the organization, but still pretty fixed, right?
It's primitive, and we all know these use cases for level one. It's like you can do an account lookup by punching in your account number through the IVR. There's also the ability to have like a way to just not punch a number, but to say what you want. I want to talk to sales, and there are some simple technologies around AI that can actually then route you to the right place. So that's kind of level one, and it's much better than level zero. And we have been operating on level one for quite a while, but then comes this world of omni-channels, and we're moving forward from this menu-based navigation on level one. We're moving to the world where we have predefined dialogue automation. That's level two. So we're going from IVRs to bots. Mm-hmm. And so the first thing is that these bots can now work over a voice channel as a voice bot, but they can also work over a digital channel. In fact, bots today work across all channels. You can have a bot talk to you through your text message, through a social channel, through a web chat, or through a voice channel. Mm-hmm. We've had at Genesys, we have facilitated about 1.5 billion conversations through bots. And so we've done this a lot. Yeah. And the benefits are pretty significant. While on level one with this IVR, you might get like an average containment rate of, let's say, 10, 15%. These bots can reach 25, 30, sometimes even up to 50% of containment. So companies are really driving a big value from that. But when you think about the other side of the conversation of the employee, you have the bot that's facing the consumer, but you also have agent assist capabilities that face the employee. So specific knowledge article would pop up, something would be highlighted to help an agent in the moment respond to an answer. And again, this can increase first call or first contact resolution numbers. It can reduce average handling time because you're pushing data towards the agent at that moment. And also important from how the experience is actually woven together, you need RPA if you're running a bot to update a backend system or some kind of workflow. So the generation of the experience is actually done with relatively deterministic capabilities around this. And so that's kind of level two. And then it gets interesting. Now we're moving towards level three. And level three is essentially defined by the arrival of generative AI. In other words, in level two, all the automation is essentially driven by humans, specifically around bots. Someone would design the flow of the conversation, right? In level three, we're moving forward. We're moving from bots to what we call virtual agents. And a virtual agent essentially is an AI, generative AI technology that leads the interaction with the consumer in the system as if it had been done by a human agent. So there's a summary of the conversation, just like a human agent typing up a summary after the call. There's a wrap-up call, right? Also, because of the use of generative AI, we have much more flexibility in articulating what we want to that automated experience as a consumer. So it understands much more because the algorithms behind it, the generic algorithms, are capable of being much more flexible in that understanding.
And that's a big difference, right? The idea that I can talk about it in my own terms, as opposed to what do you call this thing? And how,
exactly.
It's so much simpler for a customer.
Imagine a voice bot and you're asking, you're communicating with an automated system and the system asks you, okay, when was your wedding day for whatever reason? And people talk like, oh my God, yeah, wedding day. That was like 2 weeks after my mother-in-law's birthday, which is on the 15th of October. So this must be the 29th. Yes, it was the 29th. Now bots go like, oops, too much, too much information. Generic algorithms can actually figure these kind of things out. And it's not just slot filling as people who are aware how bots are being programmed. There's more to this, and the use of generative AI to make that leap is actually very, very powerful. In addition to the fact that you will be able to generate the flow based on the best conversations that your best agents had. So you're not even programming those flows in the traditional way. And so that's really what's happening in level three. Now, that's only the automation part. The augmentation part also gets super, super exciting, because now you can actually support the agent while they are working with much more capability. That agent can now actually also benefit from an automated summary. That saves like 2, maybe 3 minutes of time after the call. The agent gets prompted with a summary that suggests that they may edit it, most likely they won't, and they hit the submit button and it flies into the CRM system. Or if you have a transfer from someone who's coming, you know, from a bot conversation now into an assisted conversation by an agent, that agent doesn't have to read through like 4 pages of thread. They can just look at a summary of what happened so far and then pick it up from there. Also, you can prompt the agent with really what things to say. For example, during a troubleshooting exercise, hey, you know, you don't need to know all these things as an agent. You can actually be prompted to say these things because the AI is actually actively supporting you in this endeavor. And that has huge implications, because we still have a crisis of loyalty of employees in the contact center. And, you know, we'll have many, many more people and agents get into cloud-based contact center systems over the next couple of years. So onboarding gets much more easy with this type of technology. Ongoing coaching in the moment gets more easy, and essentially cutting down the time you need for an agent to become productive. So these co-pilots are very, very powerful. And so that's also a level three technology. And then also level three is from an experience generation perspective is predictive routing, predictive engagement, you know, using AI to start modifying the flow of the conversation. Let's say who is the best agent to serve that customer is a level three AI capability in predictive routing. Even more important, when you do journey management, if you look at all of your experiences that you provide, journey management, which is also AI supported, can actually help you find things to improve your overall business by looking at all those thousands, tens of thousands, millions of interactions that you have as a company and plotting them all out so you can find weaknesses in your experiences and address them. So level three is truly rich in innovation, mostly driven by generative AI, delivering amazing benefits to organizations.
Yeah. But it doesn't stop there. There's a couple of levels.
No, it doesn't stop there. So now we're moving from things that companies have announced that they would do or that they are actually doing. And if you watched Experience, which is our customer event in May, a lot of those technologies have been showcased. Now we're moving towards the realm of what we think is going to be possible going forward. So welcome to level four. And I must highlight, this is not a product roadmap, right? This is a vision of what we see is possible in the future. And the moniker we put on level four is empathetic experience generation. So essentially what we want to do is we want to be able to capture more of the traffic that's coming in, more of the interactions between consumers and our brand with an automated capability. For that to happen, we are not only looking at the next best action like we would in level three with a predictive routing, who's the best agent to connect, or predictive engagement, when is the right moment to engage. Now we're looking at what are the different steps that need to happen in order to solve a more complicated problem.
Yeah.
And so that's how I'm now pushing my containment rate up. So level three, we want to be consistently over 50%, but how can we get it to, let's say, 75%? And so these types of technologies are now creating an empathetic experience. And, you know, this will include avatars. This will include a high level of personalization. So we will understand much, much more what exactly consumers like, and we will cater the experience towards that. Another angle with this experience generation is that we believe more of the traffic will actually hit the back office first. Mm-hmm. So imagine you've got a mortgage approval process And essentially what's being left is for someone in the back office to go and approve that loan. You can have a work item now pushed towards a loan officer in the company, and they can actually make that distinction if, for example, you're kind of going beyond the usual amount, or you know, the consumer wants to have a discussion. Why put an agent there as the middleman when you can create a direct connection with the person in the back office specifically, because the assistance that they get, the augmentation of the experience is so good that essentially anybody can start having conversations with consumers as long as they stay with the script. There's going to be guided flows. It's going to be like a walk-up user interface from an internal perspective, as easy as using, I don't know, Uber or other applications that we're all used to on our phone. It gets really, really simple.
Yeah.
One more thing we can see happen is that these experiences will be multilingual. In other words, the co-pilot's multilingual. You can have a loan officer sitting in Mexico speaking Spanish, talking to a customer in the United States speaking English. And the conversation happens on the fly in both directions. And so imagine what that does to the way how you can actually schedule and how much more flexible you become, all the way to maybe embracing something of a gig economy around contact centers overall. So there's so much potential there by eliminating barriers of language and by actually enabling more people to communicate with customers and consumers directly, because the guidance that they get from those co-pilots is absolutely extraordinary.
Yeah, so fascinating.
So
I know there's also a level five, which is also sort of visionary.
There is a level five. We call that universal orchestration, yes.
And so we know that that's sort of coming somewhere down the line. It's, as you say, it's not product roadmap. It's more about where we see the industry going. Where do you think most organizations are today in terms of the level of experience orchestration they're at? And how do they self-assess to sort of really understand that and see where they might go next?
Yeah, we hardly meet companies that are level zero today. That would be like usually a small company who discovers, okay, we kind of need a contact center.
So it
really doesn't happen that often. Most of the time we meet companies in level one that say, okay, we understand there's this AI thing. How can we leverage this the most? And for many of the customers, it means, if you're on premise, you're pretty much stuck in level one. You will need to move to the cloud in order to leverage the levels of automation that, frankly, have become somewhat of a standard today. Many, many companies are using AI. In fact, we've done a little research. More than 40% of the Genesys cloud customers are using a form of AI. So many of them are still on level one, specifically if they're just running a voice contact center today. I would say, many companies are on level two, and probably if you had to kind of put a mark in, I think the industry is somewhere around level one and two.
Okay.
We are on the precipice of moving into level three with all these technologies like virtual agents, co-pilots, work automation, journey management, predictive routing. Those are all technologies, many of them using generative capabilities to truly deliver a step change in quality of automation, containment, and quality of the experience itself. And so that's kind of where people are right now. If you know anyone in level four or level five, I want to talk to them. level five specifically means that we move towards universal orchestration, where we mostly have a personal virtual concierge, and where most of the conversation is going to be asynchronous. So for example, hey, it's almost like having your personal executive assistant, like, hey, can you move the meeting by an hour? Or even more important, can you move the flight by an hour? Or hey, I need to fly a day later, which means, okay, change the flight, change the hotel, change transportation. There is so many more things that are happening. And so more complex things can be done in an asynchronous way. and a personal virtual concierge can actually handle it. And so that's when you would still have, in some rare cases, someone from the back office engaging with the customer directly. But now the automation is so ubiquitous and so powerful that we can essentially automate 95, maybe even more, 99% of the conversations.
Yeah. It's really just incredible to think about what that's going to look like. That point in the future.
And we may never get there. Same discussion as with autonomous cars, right? But it is in the realm of the possible, and that's why it's level 5.
That's why it's fun, yeah. So you touched on this a little bit when you were talking about level 3 and level 4, this idea that as we move up the levels, there's more integration between the front office and the back office. This becomes much more than sort of a contact center conversation and much more about how you enable your business to better serve your customers and become more efficient and all of that. Talk about that a little bit and why, this is about business success, not about contact center metrics.
Yeah, I mean, since I joined Genesys, 6 years ago, the discussion has always been the customer experience becomes so important because it's harder and harder to actually differentiate the product experience.
Right.
Product cycles get so quickly, right? And brand management has kind of moved into the social media realm, right? So everything's very, very different today. And so the importance of delivering superior experiences is essential to the differentiation in your industry. Think of how companies like Tesla, Airbnb, Uber, and others have really transformed the experience, and in this way have actually put themselves into the leadership position in a variety of different industries.
Yeah.
And what's happening is, and I found that fascinating, when you are delivering an extraordinary experience, what happens is that what people initially think is that you fulfill a functional need becomes an emotional need. So in other words, I got to go to a specific place, right? I need to fly to Washington. So I have a functional need to get on a plane and travel to Washington. If I am excited about the experience, I'm going to have an emotional need to fly with that airline.
Yeah.
And so that's really what companies are trying to do. And so the quality of the experience is so essential. And it is not enough to just leave that to agents. We want to enable the entire organization in the way how it orchestrates these experiences for customers and break the barriers between the front and the back office. Because that, I think, is needed for the entire organization to really lean in and to deliver those extraordinary experiences to customers.
Yeah.
And that means it will break out of the contact center.
Yeah.
That's why we're delivering things like journey management, collecting events from across the board, not just in the contact center. That's why we're doing things like task and work automation, where we can actually take a piece of work and move that into the back office. Those are the beginnings of this kind of transition.
Yeah. We could talk about that all day, because I feel that in my own personal life, that when I'm interacting with an organization, like it doesn't matter to me where I'm interacting with them, but that totality of it, that totality of that experience really is what forms the core of that relationship and that emotional response with the brand, much more than the product or service, because as you say, that's the need, but then what's the surround around that need, and how do you deliver something that really hooks that person to make them a customer for life.
So
for organizations that are watching and saying this is great, and they want to level up, they want to move from level 1 to level 2, from level 2 to level 3.
Yes.
There's a lot that goes into that. It's technology, it's understanding business value.
Yep.
What is needed from a business perspective starting there for an organization to level up?
So first of all, we should understand that rarely is a company consistent with the level across automation, augmentation, generation, and optimization. So in other words, a company may have a voice contact center that's based on an IVR, and so their automation level would be level 1, but they have predictive routing running, so their way of generating the experience is actually already level 3.
Right.
So nobody is in one place. So what's really key is to understand the value of leveling up. So if I go from level one to level two, and I can move my containment rate from 10% in the IVR to, let's say, 30 or 40 or 35% with a bot, that delivers significant value, and I can put a dollar number against that. Mm-hmm. Or if I'm moving from a level two agent assist, where I'm bringing information to the agent during the conversation, to a level three copilot, I can say, hey, that copilot's going to eliminate the time I'm spending, or most of the time I'm spending, with after call work. Yeah. So those 3 minutes with every conversation, I can just multiply that, get to the minutes saved. That's a dollar number. Yeah. So understanding the value of moving from A to B is truly important. But that's not all. It is so important that we truly manage the human side of that transformation. There's a lot of people who say agents are going to be obsolete, and I could not disagree more. We will have more agents, at least in level three, than we had before, because there's so much more ease to interact, and interaction numbers go up across the board. There's not enough automation that we can bring in at the right pace to even balance that. So making agents more efficient is super important. I would even go so far to say 2024 is the year of the copilot, because that's truly where a lot of the value sits that's untapped right now. And so understanding the human side, understanding the change management, making employees part of the transformation is as important as deciding to go there. And then the third, you mentioned it, Greg, is the technology platform. Because rarely companies are at the same place everywhere, the importance of having a single platform that sits underneath with a single data model, with the homogeneous approach to development, with an ongoing innovation is important, because now you have flexibility in where do you move how far without running into a mind-blowing integration exercise every time you make a move.
Yeah.
If you had a variety of different vendors to try to do the same. And so this single platform and this idea of having an all-in-one AI-powered orchestration platform in Genesys Cloud is very, very important, and will actually increase the likelihood of success as companies are leveling up.
Yeah, you know, we just released some research about where we looked in part at sort of employee attitudes about AI, and especially looking at younger generations. I mean, they have this sort of cautious optimism about, this is going to make my life better as an employee. This is going to open up new opportunities. Yeah. But they also express a little bit about what you just touched on, Peter, which is help me get there, right? Train me, show me the benefits. And so I think it's so important for organizations as they roll out these technologies and as they level up to bring their employee base along.
Correct.
So that they're part of delivering that kind of experience that you're talking about.
Yep.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay, so as we wrap up, what advice would you have for someone who's watching who says, okay, great, I'm all in, I want to level up. What advice would you give them as they think about their own journey towards delivering exceptional experiences?
So the first thing is free your mind from thinking about AI as only an aspect of automation. It's not only about reducing cost. It is actually about making better experiences happen. And so generating experiences and optimizing experience over time to drive loyalty is as important, because loyalty means future revenue, right? And so that's my first piece of advice. Like, embrace a bigger perspective in terms of what AI can do in the contact center and beyond. That's number one. Number two, we understand there's many technologies in play, and we've had very, very good success with companies helping them move different aspects of experience orchestration in their company. So talk to Genesys, talk to the partners about how to start adopting specific use cases in this overall evolution of our industry. Yeah. Because honestly, AI is a strategic imperative. There is no way that I think companies will be competitive in the future if they don't start embracing this. Yeah. If you can't automate more of the simple stuff, you cannot free up your agents to deliver an exceptional experience when things get complicated.
Yeah.
Because for the foreseeable future, those very complicated and very emotionally charged conversations will still be routed to humans.
Yeah.
And so those are the kind of things. So, you know, embrace it, lean into it, understand it's bigger than automation, and talk to companies like Genesys, talk to our partners in the field to help to deliver or to develop that kind of strategy. And then space is moving fast. Stay tuned in. There's lots of news here about what's going to be possible. But at the end of the day, what counts is what have we implemented and what return on investment have we created through the use of experience orchestration on Genesys Cloud.
Thank you very much, Peter. I want to thank you all for watching. We've been talking with Peter Graf, Senior Vice President of Strategy at Genesys, about the levels of experience orchestration. Thanks for joining us in the green room, Peter. And if you enjoyed the show, please like or share. I'm Greg Thomas from Genesys. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time in the CX Greenroom.